I would like to say good afternoon and welcome to all of you. My name is Trey Graham. It's my privilege to be the pastor here, and it's our privilege to host this service in honor of one of our favorite people. Mrs. Browning was a very, very important part of this congregation for many, many years. There's something that you probably have already noticed that is quite unusual at a funeral service. If you look to the far side over here and the far side of the room over there, you will see lots of cardboard boxes and garbage bags, not normally part of the setup for a funeral service. They are there for two reasons. Number one, all of these boxes and bags were packed last night by the members of this church as part of our Christmas Angels ministry. So they were packed last night to be distributed this Saturday. But the more important reason is that ministry was started by Helen Browning almost 50 years ago. And so we thought there's no better legacy of her life than for you to be able to see what's still going on as a part of her legacy, as a part of her memory. So there are lots and lots of families that are going to be ministered to and blessed this Christmas, and you can see evidence of that right there. I'd like to say a prayer of blessing over this family and begin our service, please. Our Father, we want you to be lifted up. We want Jesus to be honored and glorified. We thank you for Helen Browning's life. We loved her. So many people loved her. She loved her family. She loved her church family. She loved her neighbors and her friends. She loved her Savior Jesus. So thank you that after a long and beautiful life on this earth, she now enjoys the presence of the Savior face to face. We pray comfort and peace for this family and pray for you to be honored and glorified by this service. In the name of the Savior we pray, hallelujah and amen. When you live to be 98 years old, your obituary is 98 pages long. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about Helen's life, but could not dare summarize it in just a few words. Helen was born on May the 24th, 1922. Passed away just a few days ago on December the 5th at the age of 98. Born to Van Buren and Sybil Garvin. She was the fifth of eight children. There were four girls and four boys. Her sisters Gladys, Juanita, and Merle. Her brothers Doc, Ollie, Bud, and Henry. And as you saw when we came in just a moment ago, a very large contingent of family here. Her daughter Sandra. Husband JR. Her son James or Buddy is here as well. Grandchildren, Danny and Tanya, Susan and Leon, Eric and Christy, great-grandchildren, Dana and Fred, Donna and Josh, Kara and Justin, Tana and Brett, Cody and Casey, great-great-grandchildren, Brody, Brack, Bowen, Strawn, Scout, Hudson, Sawyer, Levy, Quinley, and a new baby girl coming in February. She spent her early years of her life on the family farm, caring for livestock and not picking cotton, but pulling cotton. She was a person of fun and games and laughter, even as a young child. The family was known to have square dance parties at their home. And it was at one of those square dance parties that she met a young fellow named J.W. Browning. Their first date was spent dancing, and their only date was spent dancing. They were married just a few days later, February the 14th of 1941. I believe we have a photograph of Mr. and Mrs. Browning. They were married for 66 years before Mr. Browning passed away. couple of more photographs we have to show you. There they are, sharp-looking people in 1941. Shortly after their wedding, they moved here to Melissa, Texas. That's where Sandra and Buddy were born. And very soon after that, Mr. Browning joined the United States Marine Corps and served in World War II. Helen was working as well in various industries during the war. Over her career, she worked as a telephone operator, she worked at the post office, she worked at Texas Instruments, and she ran the water department for the city of Melissa. I mentioned to you the program that we now call our Christmas Angels Ministry. That's these gifts that you see. That ministry, as I told you, was started almost 50 years ago by Mrs. Browning. And I believe there might be some privacy issues that would be raised today. But in those days, she figured if you couldn't pay your water bill, then you couldn't afford Christmas for your family. So that's how the names were first gathered for this program. Was she was looking at your water bill to see if you could afford Christmas at the time. They traveled around to many different states, but always maintained their home in Melissa. She was a member of our congregation for 79 years. In fact, you'll hear just a moment from now from Morgan Malone, who was a pastor of our church prior to my time. There have been 38 pastors. I am number 38 in the history of this church. And I was Helen's 17th pastor in the history of this church. And because Morgan doesn't have a mic, I'll tell you, I was her favorite pastor in the history of this church. Morgan can come and say the same here in just a moment. She taught all types of Sunday school classes and vacation Bible school classes in this church. She was involved in all kinds of sporting events with her own children, with the city of Melissa, with the Melissa Cardinals. She helped all sorts of ministries and programs in this city. I asked for a couple of folks to write memories of Mrs. Browning. Reed Greer is the mayor of our city, and Reed said many things. So I'll read a few of his comments to you. I will not remember Helen Browning for what she did. I will remember Helen Browning for who she was. She was a shining light of goodness that was immediately felt as soon as you saw her. Reed says, a few years back, Helen walked over to a table where I was sitting having a conversation with a lady who was at least 15 years younger than Helen at the time, and the lady commented how she couldn't imagine living to Helen's age. And Reed writes that Helen got down in her track stance and just started running in place and said, that's how you do it. Reed writes, Helen is often referred to as Miss Melissa. That term was not just one of endearment, but a true testament of who she was and will still be. For anyone who has lived here more than a few years, there are few who do not have some sort of fond memory of seeing or talking to Helen Browning. He mentions her at different places. He mentions her here at our church, and he says, however, there was nowhere Helen would rather be than watching her Melissa Cardinals boys or girls teams on the field, court, or track. Rarely was she at a sporting event to support an individual player. She was there to support her team. She says, Mrs. Helen Browning, I will always remember you and miss that huge grinning smile. That was from our friend Reed Greer, our mayor. George James is a member of the school board of Melissa. He's here, as a part of our church, and he also wrote a few of memories. Helen Browning is and always will be the queen of Melissa. She has been a dependable volunteer at our church every Sunday, even into her 90s. Her love for the children of Melissa is unparalleled. And George writes, while we do not keep tabs, it's unquestionable that Helen attended more sporting events than anyone in the history of Melissa. It did not matter what activity it was, if the Melissa kids were performing, she wanted to be there to support them. George writes about taking Helen to games in other cities and driving her as part of the family to go visit and watch teams play. Being recognized as a Citizen of the Year by the Chamber of Commerce and being the Grand Marshal in the parade and being placed on the Wall of Honor at Melissa ISD were real honors for Helen that meant a great deal to her. George says, but these honors, while they are the best we have to offer, do not fully capture the importance Helen has made to Melissa. We have a few more photos we want to show you. There is Miss Helen working at the food line, that same kind of event, packing boxes. It was performed last night in this very room. There are her children and grandchildren of this program, ladies within the church that she trained to help run this different ministry. And there is a picture of September 2017 when the city of Melissa, there's Mr. Greer in the middle of this photograph. September 6, 2017 was declared Helen Browning Day in the city of Melissa. And that's what that photograph shows. You can continue to tell many, many parts of her story. And her life was a beautiful one, filled with memories, filled with friendships, and she will be missed greatly by those who love her. In just a moment, I'm going to ask our friend Kevin Barham to come to the piano. He's going to lead you at Miss Helen's request and at the family's request through a couple of songs. In between those songs, Morgan will come and share his memories of Helen Browning, and we'll continue our service as we go forward. So please, Kevin Barham.
All right, as we do some music here, the request from the family and from Helen is that you guys join in and sing along with this thing. We're here to celebrate her life, and so she wanted these things done with lots of singing and lots of celebration. So sing with, all right?
Well, I heard an old story, how the Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood's atoning. I repented of my sin and won the victory. Jesus, my Savior forever, he sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. Cleansing power revealing, how he made the lame to walk again and caused the blind to see. And then I cried, did Jesus come and heal my broken spirit? And somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory. Jesus, my Savior forever, he sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I meant a mansion he has built for me in glory. about the streets of gold beyond the crystal sea, and about the angels singing and the old redemption story. And some sweet day I'll sing up there the song of victory. Sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. He plunged me to victory beneath.
Thank you so much, Kevin. That was a joy to get to sing with you again. It is a privilege for me to get to share with you following the lead of Trey. I would say I'm number 15, pastor number 15 on the list. But Kathy and I first met Helen when we moved here in 1990. We lived in what was the traditional First Baptist Melissa Parsonage on the north end of Highway 5, and Helen and J.W. lived south of us, about two blocks. So we were always really close to them. The things that we have heard about Helen are incredible. She was a greater than life kind of person. She had that kind of personality. And she and J.W. kind of balanced each other, right? I remember conversations I had with J.W. I did a lot of talking, and he did a lot of listening. I honestly think that's how Helen and J.W. worked out so well, right? She would do the talking and he would do a whole lot of listening. He was a guy who didn't say a whole lot, but when he said something, it had meaning. And obviously they had a good relationship and lived a long life together. They were a model of what we would say would be a successful marriage. As her pastor, she was an incredible lady. I appreciate so much Trey bringing up the Christmas angel gathering. I remember doing that as well, and I can remember one of the interesting things to me about doing that was that we would not let people turn in their own names. We would secretly go around and try and figure out when I did it or helped with it. We would go to the school, and then we would also check with the water department. And I'm sure, Trey, we'd get into a lot of trouble today for that reason. So literally, we would take these items to people's houses, and they were not anticipating they were going to be receiving anything. I mean, it was a true blessing and a true surprise, and it was an exciting event that Helen loved and our church enjoyed and the rest of the community of Melissa rallied around. As has been stated several times, Helen was kind of the queen of Melissa. I mean, she was always championing Melissa. I can remember that she was the official greeter for Melissa. Once again, she had access to the water department. When she found out about new connects via the water department, she was the one who went to the house and welcomed them to Melissa. And then we leaned on her, didn't have to lean too much, but we said, can you invite them to the church as well? And she was willing to do that. So she was all representing the city, and she was representing First Baptist Church, and she was one great lady. I don't know that we'll all be like that, right? Some of us are not as outgoing as Helen was. But Helen understood how God had made her, and she practiced that principle. She was what I would call an optimistic lady. She was an encourager. I remember several years ago a man telling me the story about a new guy who had come to town. And the new guy came to town and he asked this gentleman, he said, "How do you find the people here?" And the man said, "Well, how did you find the people where you came from?" And he said, "Well, I found them to be friendly and I found them to be encouraging." And the man said, "Well, you'll find people like that here." Wasn't maybe a day or two later, another new person came to town and visited with the old sage, and he said, "How do you find the people here?" And the sage responded back, "Well, how did you find them where you came from?" And he said, "Well, they were mean and cruel." And he said, "Well, you'll find people like that here too." You see, Helen was the kind of lady, though, who was like the first one, wasn't she? She always saw the good in people. She was an encourager. And when people were around her, they were encouraged. As her pastor, I can't tell you how exciting that was to me and how encouraging it was to me to have someone like that. That's just her nature. Some of you would say, "You know, that's not my nature." That's okay. The reality is, though, that it was for Helen, and she did a great job of it. She taught my daughter Jeffrey and GA's Girls in Action, a missions organization. She taught for years in Vacation Bible School. She taught Raynell as a child Sunday school teacher. She loved children, and she was willing to invest in them. A quality that, as a pastor, I was always in search of was that someone who was willing to serve. And she was willing to do that, and she did it by caring for children. Something else about Helen and JW was they loved baseball. I can remember having conversations with her, and we would talk about the Texas Rangers, and we would talk about how we loved them and when they were good and when they were bad, and she enjoyed that, and she enjoyed going to the games. Finally, I would say this to you. I know of no one else who showed love the way that Helen Browning showed love. Do you know how she did that? She would pinch you. The first time she did that to me, I said, "Helen, what are you doing?" She said, "Well, I am showing you that I love you." And I said, "Helen, you're pinching me." I know, but that's how I show I love you. And so from then on, anytime I saw Helen, whether it was every day or when I left here in 1999, anytime I would see her, I would be the first one to pinch her. And I would say, "I love you." So I need you to do me a favor today. At some point, I need you to pinch someone. Not hard, but I need you to pinch them and say to them, "I'm doing this in memory of Helen." That's how she showed her love. May you and I be individuals who are encouragers. May you and I be individuals who care for people. And may you and I be pinchers who can show love. Thank you.
That might be the first time I've been told that by a preacher. Go out and be a pincher. It's good. Well, let's sing together again. This is another song that we're going to need your help on. So lift this up. Let's enjoy celebrating Helen together. Some glad morning when this life is o'er, I'll fly away to our home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away. I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. When the shadows of this life have grown, I'll fly away. Like a bird from prison bars has flown, I'll fly away. I'll fly away.
fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. Just a few more weary days and then I'll fly away to a land where joy shall never end. I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory. I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly. Let's sing that chorus again together. I'll fly away, oh glory. I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. I'll fly away.
We gather this afternoon to remember someone who has left us, to remember someone who led a beautiful life, and now we mourn their loss. There was a time when a group of friends gathered together to mourn the loss of someone, but it was before they were gone. When we read the Gospel of John chapter 14, Jesus gathers his best friends, the closest people to him, his disciples, together, and he says, guys, I've got to tell you some news. I'm going to be leaving you soon. He starts off the conversation by saying, do not let your heart be troubled. It's actually a command. Stop letting your heart be troubled. He said, I've got to go away, but don't fear. Don't be in sorrow over this. Well, you can imagine the reaction of his friends. They said, we are going to be troubled. In fact, we already are troubled. We've now spent 3.5 years of our lives walking with you, eating with you, listening to you teach, seeing you touch people's lives, seeing you heal people's sickness. We're going to be sorrowful. How are we not supposed to be troubled? We're hurting. Jesus did not say, time heals all wounds. He didn't say, don't worry, be happy. He said, believe in God. You need someone to comfort you. You need someone to recognize your pain. You believe in God. You also believe in me. I'm the remedy for the troubled heart. I'm the memory, or the remedy, that is, for the sorrow that you are feeling. Depend on me. Stay close to me. And then Jesus said, when I leave, what I'm going to do is I'm going to go get a place ready for you. I'm going to prepare a spot for you so that I'm going to come back and get you and receive you to myself, and so that where I'm going to be, you can be there also. But these guys were in grief and they couldn't think very clearly. They didn't understand what he was saying. They didn't understand this idea of you'll come meet me and we'll all be together again. And so a guy named Thomas says, Lord, we don't know where you're going, so how do we know the way? It's really the same question they were all asking. He was just the one to speak up, and he said, you tell us to follow you, but we don't know where to go. We don't know what the right path is. Which way should we go? It's a great question. It's a very important question. And it's the question that we all have to ask today, is which way are we going? Morgan mentioned to you that he and Kathy came to this church in 1990. Bretta and I and our family came in 2002. And when we moved to Melissa 18 years ago, I had to learn what Melissa directions were. Because I would try to go visit people. There's some of our deacons who were with me, and they would go places. And I would ask, how do you get to so-and-so's house? And it was never north on this street and east on that street. It was more like, you know where Joe's barn is? No. Okay. You know where Mr. Wilson used to live? No. Well, that's how you were supposed to find things. That was the way directions were given. I couldn't find places, but I had to have somebody to show me around. So the disciples of Jesus are saying, we want to go where you are, we just don't know how to get there. And what they needed was somebody to show them the way, to show them around. And what did Jesus say? He said, I am the way. I am the way. If you can't find a path, if you can't find the right street, look for me. Jesus didn't say, I'll show you the way, or I'll give you directions to the way. He said, I am the way. If you want to go to heaven, follow me. So we're tempted to ask, how do we know this is the right way? How do we know it's the correct path? I assume many of you have been here in our church before, and I assume there's a few of you who've never been to this church before. And if you've never been here before, you needed directions, and the way it works today is you pull out your phone and you look it up, and that's how you find the way. And you trust that the little British lady that talks to you here knows what she's saying. Because you need a correct way. Because it's bad to have no directions, but what's worse than no directions is wrong directions. Jesus said, I am the way, but I'm the way of truth. I'm the correct way. I'm the way that leads to life. We say, well, why can't I go my own way? Why should I go your way? And Jesus said, because I'm the way that leads to life. Where we live, in a neighborhood down that way a little bit, there's one way in and one way out. There's only one road that leads you to our neighborhood, to our house. So if you're going to come to our house, there's one street to take to get there. Now, you can like that or not like that, and you can think that's narrow-minded or old-fashioned or whatever you want, but it's just a fact. If you're going to come to our house, you can't go there except by taking this one street. That's what Jesus is saying. If you want to come to my house, you can pick another road if you want. It just doesn't lead to my house. There's only one road that leads to my house. I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father but through me. See, today we gather to celebrate Helen's life, and in 98 years with so many accomplishments and so many lives that were touched, we could spend all day saying what she did for other people and how she touched the lives of other people, but guess what? As important as all of that was to Helen, that's not important to Helen right this minute. You know why? Because she's standing face to face with Jesus. That's what's important to her. And she's been reunited with Mr. Browning as Jesus was preparing a place for Helen. We read in Revelation chapter 21... about our times of mourning and sadness. It says, he will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no longer any death and no longer any mourning or crying or pain. The first things have passed away. See, we cannot change Helen's past. It's over. And her future's already begun. We can't change our past. It's over, but our future is still in front of us. Maybe another week or another year or maybe till we're 98, but our future's still in front of us. And the question is, what path are we on? What road have we chosen to live by? As we finish talking about Helen's life, there's one more photograph I want you to see. Morgan mentioned that Mr. and Mrs. Browning loved baseball. So if you know baseball, you know what this photograph is. It's called a walk-off home run. Now, what does that mean if you don't speak baseball? It means that it's the bottom of the ninth or the bottom of an inning and extra innings, and there's a team at bat, and the person at the plate hits a home run that wins the game, so the game is over on that swing, and the crowd is cheering in the stands, and all the teammates come out to home plate, and they gather around, and they're waiting for the person who hit the home run to come home. The game's over. The verdict has been decided. But what's so beautiful about this photograph is there's a whole stands full of fans. What the book of Hebrews might call the great cloud of witnesses. And then there's a whole bunch of teammates. And see, they're in a little semicircle. You know why? Because the guy that's rounding third base right now, he's the guy that hit the home run. He has one thing left to do. He has to touch home plate. The game is over, but it will not be over if he doesn't touch home plate. So they're in this circle surrounding home plate because that's what he's got to do. He's got to get home. And then he joins the team in the victory. Walk-off home run. You know what I think when I see this photograph? Those of us who have placed their faith in the Messiah named Jesus of Nazareth, especially those who for 98 years reflected the truth of who Jesus is, on December the 5th, 2020, Helen Browning rounded third base. She went home, and there's the team saying, "Welcome home. We've been waiting for you to get here." And there was Mr. Browning and other members of her family. But most of all, there's King Jesus sitting right there saying, "You made it home." Now, again, if you know anything about baseball, you can't go any direction you want. You can't go in the bases in your preferred order. You got to follow the path. There's only one way that works. You go to the first base, you got to turn right if you're at home plate, and you got to go to the first base, and then the one that's way out there, second base, and then you got to come to third base. Now you're around third and you head home. There's one prescribed route to get home where the great cloud of witnesses is waiting for you. That's what Jesus said in John 14. I'm going to go home ahead of you, start getting it ready, and I want you to come home to be with me, but don't go to the wrong base. Don't go to the wrong house. Don't go to the wrong street. Go the right way, the true way, the one way, and I'll be at home waiting for you, and we'll welcome you. I believe that's what happened just a few days ago. Helen Browning went home, and the crowds cheered. And we get to still cheer, because we're not home yet, but for those who know and love Jesus, she'll be standing there at home plate waiting for us. That's what her legacy is. Her legacy is not a ministry to people who need help buying Christmas gifts. Her ministry is not all the children that she touched. Her legacy is not all the sporting events that she went to. Her legacy is she said, "Yes, Lord Jesus, I want to be on your team." That's her legacy. Let's pray, please. Father, we love you and we say thank you for Helen's life. And Hank, thank you that she gets to experience that walk-off home run that she's been waiting for all these years, and she's finally arrived. Please show us what road to take, what road to avoid, and what road will lead us to Jesus. And this is our prayer in his name. Amen. We mentioned to you that at the family's request and at Helen's request, we have a series of songs to be played. Kevin has played two of those. There's two more. Here's the first. Have one song left, and if you know Helen and knew how Helen would tell you what she wanted you to do, you'll know what song is going to come here in just a moment as we finish. Let me explain what happens now as our service comes to an end. We're going to ask the gentlemen to please come forward. They're going to begin to prepare the casket, so you will have the opportunity to pass by. So the members of the family will remain seated where they are, and the folks behind, you're going to get to pass by and pay your respects, and then just come here and go out that aisle, right out that door. We will then prepare, after the family is finished, we will prepare to move to the graveside service here in Melissa, just down the street. Those who are interested and want to go, you're invited to join the family there for the brief graveside service that will follow. One special request, because of the world in which we now live, we're going to ask that when you come and pass by and pay your respects to Miss Helen and the family, don't stop here for hugs and handshakes. It's not the time for that. So again, just please pass by here. Again, you'll go back out there, and if you are interested in attending the graveside service, we'll do that when this is finished. So as we do that, right here, if you'll start, please, and stand where you are, sir, right there. Yep, come please pass right by, and everyone just follow along, and we will have a chance to say our final respects. Here it comes.
On the road again, just can't wait to get on the road again. The life I love is making music with my friends, and I can't wait to get on the road again. On the road again, going places that I've never been, seeing things that I may never see again. I can't wait to get on the road again.